Thank you. My name is Chandrahaasan. I'm doing my PhD at the Norwegian University of Science and Technology. And today I'd like to talk about the hydrogen effects on the nanomechanical properties of Inconel 625, which was probed using in situ electrochemical nanoindentation. So the work I'm doing is a part of a bigger project called as an MHEAT, which is a multi-scale hydrogen embrittlement assessment tool for subsea condition. The overall objective of this project is to establish an hydrogen-informed engineering framework so as to so as to assess the material which is exposed to hydrogen condition in subsea conditions. So I am working in the work package 2, which basically concerns with multi-scale experiments. So the idea is to perform multi-scale experiments and probe the embrittlement mechanisms. And today I will talk about my research from nano indentation test. One of the major advantages of nano indentation test is that you can probe the volume of the material, which is extremely small, and get useful information. For instance, if you see this curve, this is typical load displacement data for well-annealed ductile material. It consists of 4 stages, and from each stage, you can extract some useful information. The first stage belongs to is called as the elastic stage, where you can measure the modulus of the material. And the second stage, which is a sudden displacement burst, which we call it as a pop-in, which is used to measure the load at which the dislocation nucleation happens. And then there is a third stage, elastoplastic, which is used to define the hardening process. And then finally, the unloading stage, which is generally used to measure the hardness of the material. So for this talk, my talk would be mainly centered around characterizing these properties from this low displacement data as a function of hydrogen concentration. To begin with, this is the initial microstructure which we received from the supplier. So basically, the microstructure is homogeneous with quite a large fraction of annealing pin boundaries. From the BSE image, probably you could not see that there is quite a large fraction or discrete fractions of white precipitates. When we do the EDS mapping, these precipitates were found to be enriched with niobium, molybdenum, carbon. And we also know this material was rolled and annealed at 885 degrees Celsius. So we expect these precipitates are of carbide type. Coming into the methodology, this is the schematic of our electrochemical setup. As you can see, we placed the sample at the bottom, and the reference and platinum electrodes are placed at appropriate positions. The glycerol is our electrolyte, which stays in contact with the surface of the sample. The advantage of using glycerol is that it has a proven ability to maintain the surface during charging process. So one of the advantages of using this in-situ setup is we can charge the sample continuously during indentation. So the measured properties correlates directly under the influence of hydrogen alone. And another advantage is it is possible to monitor the surface during charging as well as during indentation. For my current experiment, this is the polarization graph I used to choose different cathodic and anodic potential. And this is the EBSD map post indentation, as you can see. So these are the sequence of indents I performed at different cathodic and anodic sequence. At first, I performed the indents in air. Then I charged my materials at 1200 millivolt for 2 hours, and then performed in over this region. Then I charged my material again for 2 hours, and the indents over this region. By this way, I performed indents in different potentials. The hydrogen content here is the total hydrogen content, which belongs to each of the cathodic potentials. And the hydrogen content has been measured using the TDS technique. Okay, this is the typical, or this is the representation of the low displacement data for air sample. So when I charge my sample, as you can see, there is a small reduction in the pop-in load and pop-in width, and there is an increase in hardness value. So when I when I change the potential to anodic, which is 0 millivolt, the pop-in load and pop-in width retains to that of air, but the hardness value does not retain to the original value of the air. What I did again is I changed my potential to higher cathodic potential, which is 1700 millivolt, and you can see a drastic decrease in the pop-in load and pop-in width, and there is a significant increase in the hardness value. When I change the potential back to anodic, the pop-in load and pop-in width almost retains to that of the air. However, the hardness value here is much lower than that of the air. So these are the three key points which I'd like to discuss in this presentation. The first one is hydrogen influence on the pop-in load and pop-in width. And then when I charge my sample, I could see the formation of slip lines. It's not clear here, but I could see the formation of slip lines at 1,700 millivolt. And then I want to discuss the hydrogen influence on the hardness. So the first point, the hydrogen reduced pop-in load, it can be explained based on the defectant theory. So basically, according to classical dislocation nucleation concept, the free energy required to nucleate a dislocation can be expressed with this term. With hydrogen charging or under the presence of hydrogen, the first two terms in this equation, which is the energy required to create a dislocation loop and energy required to create a stacking fault energy, is reduced. In other words, hydrogen tends to reduce the activation energy required for a dislocation loop. Therefore, the load required to initiate plasticity in hydrogen-charged sample is reduced. The hydrogen-reduced pop-in width, in order to understand that, here I have plotted the pop-in load as a function of pop-in width, and the slope can be correlated to the hardening process. With hydrogen charging, there is an increase in slope, which suggests that increasing the hydrogen concentration increases the lattice frictional stress. One other observation is hydrogen-induced slip. As you can see, these are the series of the scanning probe images which I captured at different potentials. It's not clear, but the surface remains intact when the potential is lower, which is 1,200 and 1,400 millivolt. However, at 1,700 millivolt, I could clearly see the slip lines. In order to quantify the slip line formation, I tried to estimate the internal stress based on this relation. So I know the total hydrogen content for 1,200 millivolt and for 1,700 millivolt. So when I estimate the stress at the surface, which is 175 megapascal in 1,200, whereas in this case, which is 1 gigapascal, which is far higher than the yield strength of the material. Furthermore, I also plotted here the diffusion profile for two of these potentials. As you can see, there is a quite steep concentration gradient when the potential is higher. So combination of sluggish diffusion and the supersaturation of hydrogen at the surface is the most likely reason for the slip line formation during hydrogen charging. Coming into the hardness increase, there is a progressive increase in hardness with the cathodic potential. This can be directly correlated with the hydrogen content. Here I have included the Ecke image. This again is not properly clear. But the thing is, when I try to measure the average dislocation spacing from the Ecke indents, I could see a progressive reduction in the dislocation spacing with the hydrogen charging. So the main dominant mechanism for increase in hardness value is hydrogen solute pinning the dislocations. Finally, I wanted to discuss about this hardness recovery. As you can see, once I charge my sample until 1,400 millivolt and then come back to the 0 millivolt, there is a reduction in hardness. But when you compare to that of the air, there is still 6% increase. In order to understand this phenomenon, I tried to correlate with the simple diffusion and desorption model. So this is the diffusion profile after 2 hours of charging, and this is the hydrogen profile after 1 hour of discharging. So the hardness value or the region at which the plastic zone depth at which hardness is influenced can be calculated based on this Lond model relation. And for my present case, the depth which influenced the hardness value is roughly around 875 nanometers. At this depth, after 2 hours of charging, roughly 88% of hydrogen present, and 1 hour of discharging, 7% of hydrogen is present. So after the sequence, which is charging for 2 hours and then desorbing for 1 hour, roughly around 7.6% of hydrogen still remain in this case. And this residual hydrogen could cause this 6% increase in this case. An interesting observation is that after higher cathodic potential, I measured the hardness, which is far lower than that of the air. And I tried to measure the hydrogen content in this case. There is roughly around 0.11 ppm, which is 10% from the 1,700 millivolt. So the reason for this drop in hardness could be formation of the non-equilibrium plakensis during hydrogen charging, actually. To conclude my talk, the pop-in load reduction is due to the hydrogen enhanced dislocation nucleation, and pop and width reduction is the enhanced lattice friction, and the slip line formation is generated because of the internal stress due to sluggish diffusion and the supersaturation of hydrogen at the surface. The hardness increase is explained by solute drag effect, and non-recovery at low potential is present of the residual hydrogen, and recovery at higher potential is possibly due to the formation of non-equilibrium electrostatic clusters. Yeah. Thanks for listening.